Good evening and welcome to another APS Business Talk. I'm Leanne Bujeya, Senior CSR Officer at APS Bank. For today's talk, we'll be addressing the question, is work-life balance a utopian dream? During the next hour, our speakers, Patrick Psaila and Joanne Mamo from PsyPotential, will address some of the main challenges employees experience to maintain a healthy balance between their personal and professional commitments. They will present examples of personal strategies, organizational culture, and leadership practices, which are most conducive to the overall well-being of employees. Patrick is a warranted psychologist and training consultant with over 20 years of experience working with organizations. He specializes in personal and professional development for leaders and organizations, with a particular interest in emotional intelligence and leadership. He is passionate about empowering and enabling people to reach their full potential and become the best version of themselves. Joanne is a training and HR practitioner and a licensed psychometrician. Joanne focuses on designing and delivering bespoke training programs, supporting HR projects, as well as assessing and interpreting the results of psychometric assessments in diverse industries. She is committed towards enabling people to grow through the development of self-awareness. Before handing over to our speakers, I would like to remind you that you can use the Q&A function to write your questions, which will be addressed at the end of the presentation. Now I'm going to hand over to Patrick to start the session.
Hi. Hello. Good evening, everyone. I hope you had a relatively pleasant day. It's the end, reaching the end of the day. And Joanne and I are very pleased to be presenting this short discussion about work-life balance. I will start by sharing the screen so that you can follow easily. So I'll be sharing right now. Okay. And we can kick off, Joe, I guess. So we can start, right? Okay, so the first thing that we want to present to you is a little bit provocative, because ironically, although the topic and the title of today's presentation is about work-life balance, we are actually suggesting that we switched that and we think instead of a balanced life. So the research in this area is showing that, in actual fact, thinking of life and work as two separate entities that are not related is actually not that useful, because, let's face it, work takes so much of our time and so much of our consciousness. The best days of the week, the best weeks of the month, the best months of the year, and the best years of our life. So the idea is that, how do we integrate our professional life and those hours of the day that we spend making a living so that we can live? Because it's funny, because we call it to make a living, and very often we end up just making the living without living the life. So what we are trying to present to you this evening is a few really practical tips on how we can think of our life holistically in a way that encourages work-life balance and moves it into a balanced life. Okay, so we are suggesting this, and part of this inspiration came from this quotation from Sadhguru, where he said that there is no such thing as work-life balance. It is all life. The balance has to be within you. And we strongly believe this, and we strongly subscribe to this concept that it's all about achieving internal balance, and then automatically work-life balance will follow. Okay, Joe will be taking you through the fundamental concept now, right, Joe? So
yes, Pat, just if we can go back one slide, just if I could add something. Yes. So as Pat's saying, we do view work-life balance more being holistic, and we'd like to do a little poll. So if we could put up the poll, we're going to ask you a little question, And we're going to ask you, which aspect do you struggle most with when it comes to living a balanced life? Okay, so the poll should come up for you. And just pick the one that you struggle the most with. Maybe we'll speak a bit basically on that before we go into it.
Unfortunately, we can't vote, Joe.
No, but you'd like to share mine. Then. Yeah, which one mine is most difficult? Yes. Okay. So that's great. We'll speak about that as well. Yeah. Then we'll add our votes without adding it directly.
This here is discrimination. That we can't vote. It's not.
We're not very different from everyone else, are we?
Exactly.
Okay, so we have the poll results. They've come up. So I'm not sure if everyone can see them or not, but I'm seeing them here. So we have the first one, which was making time for my friends and family, 19%. We have keeping healthy, 29%. Doing things for myself at 29%. So those two were the highest, okay? So most people struggle with keeping healthy and doing things for yourself. Learning new things at 5%, and slowing down and reflecting on what's important at 19%. Okay, so quite a balance. I'm learning new things was kind of the lowest, and the others are relatively similar. So Pats, which one would you have cast your vote for?
I went for the first one, making time for my friends and family, because that seems to be the biggest challenge for me, at least. It's because it integrates, like I do exercise with friends and family usually. So then, it brings in the other things with it. So that's why
I definitely
went. What about you, Joe? Which was yours?
I think for me, it was the making time to try new things. Lately, I've been so busy that I don't end up trying new things. I kind of let's keep doing the things the way that I've been doing them, which is not always the best. So, this session equally challenges myself. So. So it's, I think that poll might have been a bit difficult for some of you to answer. I know it was difficult to answer myself, because most of the time we're struggling with, many of these at the same time. And we'll be talking about that, exactly that today. So, shall we move on to the five domains of well-being?
There we go.
Okay, so, as we said, we do regard well-being as being holistic. And we see it as having multiple dimensions. So here we can see the physical, the emotional, the cognitive, spiritual, and social. And we'll be going through every single one. So, Pat will be going into detail. We'll be, jumping in together. If any of you have any questions at any point, we have a Q&A. So we'll be monitoring that. Same thing if you're watching live on Facebook, we'll be able to answer any questions you have. And we'll be having a little Q&A at the end. But equally, if you have any, points you'd like to raise throughout, if you'd like to use the chat, you can do that as well. Okay, so, before we start, Pat, I thought we'd mention, we had a session recently, and we talked about the five domains of well-being, and someone mentioned, very, very rightly, that these five domains, this image shouldn't be looked at as a representation of a graph. So that, the circles, they look like they're equally represented here. And it's actually not the case that they would all be important in the same way at every time in our life. So we like to look at them sort of as five investments. And this is where I pass on to you, Pat, if you'd like to explain a bit on what that means.
Yeah, okay. So it's not because we're collaborating with APS and it happens to be a bank that we're calling them investments, but I think it's appropriate to call them that. So basically they are five domains of well-being, and the way they're linked to a balanced life is that if we constantly keep them in mind and constantly think of them as five important areas that we can keep in mind and contribute to during our living daily life, kind of, so as Joe said, if we could have an image of them growing and shrinking at the same time, an organic image that gives them more life, that's how they would look. Okay, so imagine that they're living, organic, and they're breathing. So sometimes they, they shrink, sometimes they grow, and then different times of our life, according to what we're facing, what we're going through, some take more importance over others. Shall I think, Joe, I should start going area by area. So I think it's It's an easier way rather than talk about them generically. Yes. So basically, I'm going to start. Yes, Joe?
Agreed, agreed.
Okay. So basically, I'm going to start taking them area by area. And if you have questions as we go along, obviously you can use the Q&A and we'll be sort of registering those and being able to answer them as we go along. Okay, so the first area is the physical domain, which is practically anything to do with the body. And you might ask, but why do you start with the body? And the reply is very simple, because the body is our equipment. And if you don't look after the equipment, you cannot function. So in terms of achieving balance, okay, so one of the key factors that are involved in being able to keep that balance is, first of all, to watch what we eat, as in quantity and quality, and make sure that we're giving our body and our brain food that is healthy, nutritious, and good for us, because that impacts our energy levels, it impacts how we think, it impacts how much we can put into the day, and it's critical. In fact, we call these the three non-negotiables, okay? Or sometimes we call it the slide of the non-negotiables, because nutrition, sleep, and exercise are critical. They're critical to well-being, and they're critical to achieving, to being able to achieve balance. The second area is sleep. So if I had to be seeing you, the participants out there today, and ask you how many of you are happy with the amount of sleep that you get, I think if there are young parents, you'll want to shoot me because I can understand how there is no such thing as having a good night's sleep when you have little children. But again, this is a good example when that particular circle might need to shrink a bit for a while, because you know, at least you know it's not forever, that during that time it's very challenging to get the right amount of sleep that you need. But it also means that being aware of how important it is, you can prioritize it and try to grab every opportunity to catch up when you can, and get the necessary support to catch up on your sleep when you can. Because sleep is critical. We often take it for granted because it's something we do every day. But we practically, at least we should be sleeping the same hours that we are working. More or less 8 and 8. Okay, so think about that for a while and see whether there is balance in that area. And the third area for the physical domain is exercise. And I noticed it was one of the, it scored at 29% in terms of struggle. Partly it's because in our Maltese culture in particular, although it's improved a lot, we still tend to be somewhat sedentary in terms of our mentality, and we don't kind of move for the sake of it. And we love our cars and we love sitting in them. And yet exercise is so critical for well-being and for being able to function well. So these are like the three, we call them the three non-negotiables, okay? And we like to start with that. So this is the first investment. And I'm going to now, yeah.
If I can add, just yes, those of you in the audience, I mean, we can't ask you, of course, but I can, you know, safely assume that there's a bit of a mix in terms of, you know, who's working from home, who's hybrid maybe, who's in the office. And that really has an impact as well on you know, your energy levels and your movement levels, because we know that, you know, people who tend to work from home actually don't tend to get up as much. You don't have to walk to your car. You don't have to walk up many steps, for example, you know, in staircases and so on. So just being a bit mindful of the fact that if you're at home mostly, for example, you're in an office where there isn't much space to walk around, even just standing up and stretching, you know, standing up and making a coffee and so on. We do live in a culture where, you know, we expect everything to arrive at us. We can order things right to the door. Things are, it's very easy to stay sitting all the time, but it's actually a case that standing up can actually increase blood flow and wake you up, basically. So
very much so. In fact, Joe, We had a session before this, and we were delivering a session, a 2-hour session online till 5 o'clock, and then at half five we logged into to this one. I didn't tell you, but in between sessions I was chasing the dog around the house, and we both enjoyed it very much. So
that's nice. I went downstairs actually to see my dog. She was peacefully sleeping and wasn't very happy when I went to touch her. So but I still did walk down and up one flight of stairs with
me. Exactly. No, but at least you move, you know, you end up moving.
Definitely. Definitely. Great.
Okay, so I mean, I'm gonna move on to the second area, which is the emotional domain. And here, you know, and here it starts getting a bit interesting because first of all, in terms of achieving balance, there's also the balance in general between how you feel and how you think. And investing in this domain also helps us indirectly to achieve balance because, for example, by managing emotions and managing how we feel, we can process our emotions, understand them and see what they're telling us. And that will directly impact how stressed and overwhelmed we feel and what to do when we feel that. Likewise, assertiveness. So one might ask, but how does assertiveness impact work-life balance leading to a balanced life? Of course, if we're assertive and we are able to, for example, push back when there are demands that are excessive or where we can say no assertively to certain things, or maybe not necessarily no, but it could be not for now or later or tomorrow. The fact that we can assert ourselves and invest our time where there are priorities and where it really matters is another way, an important way of, first of all, feeling good, because very often when we don't assert ourselves, we then feel angry and get angry at ourselves for not doing it. Okay, but also we end up with too much on our plate, more than we can handle. Okay, so this is another important area that can really help us to achieve balance. The last one is also practicing gratitude. And again, where does the balance come in here? Very simply, we are bombarded by negativity. And if we had to look around these last 2.5 years, like first we had COVID, and as we were emerging from COVID, we were and still are following a human tragedy, just, you know, very close to us, which is, you know, the war in Ukraine. I think we can't underestimate the impact that bad news has on us, especially when we're constantly being exposed to it and bombarded by it. And one thing that can balance this without closing our eyes to reality, because we're not suggesting in any way that we fool ourselves and, you know, live in a bubble, is to practice gratitude. So on a regular basis, acknowledge the things that we can be thankful for. So, you know, and that has a very strong impact on our emotional well-being, and also helps us to achieve this internal balance that we are referring to.
If I could add, there are, you know, there are different ways of practicing gratitude. So there's the, you know, very concretely established way of writing down, you know, three things we're grateful for every day. I can't see our faces, but normally I would expect a bit of cynicism when it comes to gratitude, because it sounds like something, you know, a bit silly. And, you know, and I would totally agree in that respect, because I have this app and it's meant to remind me every single day. It has been for a month and I've only done it twice. What's interesting is the days that I did do it was when I had a bad day. So gratitude is especially important and valuable when you have had a bad day or you're going through something very difficult. Just, you know, even if you don't need to call it gratitude and you call it something else. So you say, you know, these bad things are happening, but what good things can I take from them? So, you know, even rephrasing it that way, you know, using the language that works for you, basically. If gratitude's not a word that inspires you to think of the good, then you know, by all means, don't do that. But, you know, remaining realistic, right? So at the end of the day, you know, the other day, Pat and I were talking about negativity bias as well. Mm-hmm. And the fact that we are actually, you know, primed to focus very much on the negative things. you know, negative feedback, for example, and we ignore the positive. Something bad happened in a presentation we had to give, and we focus on that and see it as a failure. You know, and just trying to teach our brain how to look at the positive side as well, while being realistic at the same time, of course.
Okay. So moving on, we have the cognitive domain. And again, this is pertaining more to the way that we think. We separate them from feelings in a bit of an artificial way, because really, emotions and cognitions are intricately related. However, this relates more to the way that we think. And once again, if we invest time in learning how to think constructively and to possibly reframe harmful thinking patterns. Now, to do that, we don't have much time to go into much detail here, but one simple way of dealing with this is to ask yourself, does it help me, or is it useful to think in this way? So I'm going to give you an example, all right? So if we're a bit worried about something that might happen, so you know, a presentation that we might have, or an interview, or the job itself, or a promise of sale, or an investment, or whatever, okay? And we can very easily fall into the pattern of what we call catastrophizing. And catastrophizing is a habit of constantly thinking of the worst thing that can happen, and nearly living that reality before it actually happens. Okay? The reframe would be here is that you don't tell yourself, no, nothing will go wrong, everything will be fine, I don't need to worry. That's what I call false reassurance. Okay, that's what people tell us when they don't know what to say. The suggestion of the reframe is that the chances of the worst thing happening are not very high, they are slim. And even if they do, I will find a way of coping. All right? And that's the reframe. Because for most intelligent people, just telling ourselves, no, everything will be okay. No, that's not the case. You know, things do go wrong and things do happen. But saying to yourself that even if it does, I will somehow manage, I will somehow, it won't be the end of the world if I, you know. And obviously, the more serious the consequence is, the more difficult it is to do this. And I'm not suggesting that it's an easy thing, but trying to reframe harmful thinking is very critical in this area. The other one is developing a growth mindset combined with continuous learning. So dedicating time to be open, to change, to look at struggle and failure as part of learning rather than an end in itself, to look at mistakes as growth opportunities, to see them as, you know, opportunities to say, okay, what can I learn from this? How can I prevent this from happening again? I'm a work in progress. Okay, so Joe and I like to refer to it as either the work in progress mindset, mm-hmm, or the beginner's mentality. Okay, a beginner accepts that they don't know everything and that they are constantly learning, and there's that curiosity around it. Want to add something, Joe? Yeah.
Yes, please. So when we look at learning continuously, you know, automatically in my mind, I think, you know, of online training programs, for example. Mm-hmm. But what are the other ways that we can learn continuously?
Yeah, so there are, so you're asking me, Joe, right?
Yes. Okay. Yes, if you could just expand a bit, because, you know, sometimes we assume that it has to be, you know, very formal.
Exactly. Yes. This is the beauty of live broadcast. In fact, if we adopt a beginner's mindset and a curious mindset, in a way, reconnect with the child inside us that is curious and wants to learn. We can learn informally from everything. We can learn from, you know, informal conversations that we have with people, from experiences that we see. It's living mindfully with a mentality that a hunger or thirst for learning that is really, really already there, because as human beings, our brain is a learning brain constantly. Okay, this is how we came up with artificial intelligence in reality, because we realized that just as our brain is constantly learning, we can create an intelligence that also learns. So we are so wired to learn that we try, now we are trying to create machines that learn as well. Okay, so learning is critical. And nowadays, you know, we live in a knowledge economy, so it is knowledge workers and knowledge professions that are the way forward in the future. So this is, I think, another area that is worth investing in on a regular basis.
Definitely. I mean, by learning continuously, we open our minds to new ideas, new values, you know, new ways of you know, working or of living from other people. So, you know, this applies to what you consume, you know, on a regular basis. So the things that you read, the things that you watch, the people that you speak to, and the conversations that you facilitate. So, you know, even at work, starting conversations with colleagues that you only talk about, you know, on certain projects, and opening up the conversation about the way that you work, for example, or the way that you do things, you can really learn from them or even help them, for example, to be more effective or to be more mindful. And yeah.
Okay, so the next important investment in achieving balance and working towards having a balanced life is to, first of all, look at meaning and purpose. So we call this the spiritual domain, but by spiritual, in this case, spiritual is a very broad definition. So it includes the purely human spirituality, which is a focus on meaning and purpose and core values, living your values. But it can also obviously embrace the divine and the transcendental. So that is where we refer to a higher power or a god or like basically faith. Okay, so faith in something that is beyond our cognition and our ability to understand. Okay, that thing that we call mystery that we can never really grasp. And then there is the third aspect, which is the form that takes. And religion basically is giving spirituality specific form. Okay. For the sake of psychological growth and internal balance, we don't really distinguish and we don't try to say, wow, this is better than the other, so it's better to have faith or religion or values or human spirituality. What is important are these three fundamental areas. So one of them is that we search for meaning and purpose in our lives. We try to live according to our core values. So the more aligned we are with our values, the less tension we feel between what we are doing and the purpose that it has for us. This is how it relates directly into balance, because basically, and this is why we move more towards internal balance and a balanced life than work-life balance. Because I'm going to give you an example. If my work and the contribution I give through my work is so important to me and it gives me such fulfillment and sense of purpose that it kind of really, really nurtures me and my spirit, then how can I separate it from my life? Okay, if it's part of my mission, if it's part of the way that I contribute to other people, to society, how can I separate it from my life? What I can do is make sure that I don't work too hard and get too tired, for example. And that's where the physical, you know, the sleep, the rest and the exercise comes in. So rather than trying to create artificial boundaries between my life and my work, it's more achieving balance. So there has to be a time during the day when you say, okay, for today, I've worked enough. Now it's time to do other things. Okay, so rather than try to split, now I stop working and now I start living. Because when you think about it, Joe, I don't know whether you've thought about this, but when you say work-life balance, it's like, so when you're working, you're not living.
Exactly.
You know, so it's a very artificial term. It's so popular, you know, but it's
quite an old notion that has stuck with us in a way that when you enter, you know, your workplace, you've left your personal life at the door. But we know, you know, it's a reality that, you know, throughout the day, we have different emotions, for example, we have different thoughts. At the end of the day, something that you, you know, watched in the evening the night before might actually bring you an idea at work. So the two really do overlap. And I don't think it's a very healthy mindset to really try separate them entirely.
Exactly. Exactly. In fact, what some of you might be saying, if I can read minds, is that, but isn't it important to leave work at work and your life at life? But usually what we're talking about here is healthy boundaries. Of course, yes, every there has to be a boundary between my life at work, my working life, and my family life, and my social life. And okay, but these are all aspects of the self. So what we're trying to do is present you with a holistic framework, which will actually reduce the struggle.
Mm-hmm.
Because, for example, if you go for a walk or to the gym during the break, you are actually integrating the physical domain into your work. Isn't that balance? You went home and your exercise is ready, for example, I'm saying. Okay. The last area is giving time for reflection, because one of the things that keeps us out of balance sometimes is that we don't give ourselves enough time to reflect and think about what we're doing. And this can take various forms. It can take the form of just stopping and slowing down a bit, and reflecting on our day and what we're doing. It could take the form of meditation, which is a little bit more of a skill and gives it more structure. It can take the form of quiet time and prayer and connecting to our deep internal spirituality. But whatever it is an opportunity to reflect and, you know, reach inside kind of and see how we are actually feeling and what we are doing.
Okay. If I could add, so another way you can reflect, if you know you're not the kind of person who tends to reflect individually, is even reflecting with others. So for example, one of the things that we've started doing actually as PsyPotential is doing sort of peer supervision sessions where we discuss, you know, things we're struggling with, for example, which really encourages, you know, everyone to accept the fact that we all struggle, we're not perfect beings, and we help each other. So you can also reflect on things that have happened as a team, for example, with your colleagues.
Yes, and that's a really good way of introducing that even in the workplace.
Exactly.
In fact, we call it reflective practice.
Mm-hmm.
So in professions and in the workplace, it means that you practice mindfully. Okay, so and it's a very good way. Actually, it also feeds the cognitive domain because it's an excellent way of learning. But you learn through other people's experiences. So yeah,
absolutely,
really, really important. Okay, now we have the last domain is the social domain, and if it's the last one, it's definitely not the least important, because in terms of balance and direct input into well-being, because let's face it, if we had to really think about it, this whole idea of balance is so that we feel well, so that we live a good life, okay? And there are a number of studies that have been carried out, some of them longitudinal, so they've been going on for a number of years. One of them in particular has been going for 80 years, where they have interviewed the sample is always growing, it's now thousands of people. They interview them, they take x-rays, blood tests, MRI scans, interview their relatives, all about health and well-being. So how much of a happy life they are living. And the one thing that dominated everything else in terms of what keeps us healthy and happy as we age was relationships. A meaningful connection with other people. So time spent with people, meaningful time, you know, I'm not talking about, you know, just surfing social media, and I'm talking about quality time with people. deep personal connections with people is such a massive investment, and it buffers us from the scourge of loneliness. So I'm sure you people out there can identify with this, that one of the things that COVID did to us because of social isolation and social distancing is that people who were already struggling with loneliness, especially the elderly, ended up not only lonely, but even isolated. And we know for certain, we even have data showing this, that incidence of depression, anxiety, even conditions like dementia and Alzheimer's, they actually grew exponentially because of the isolation that COVID brought about. So I think this is like the other side of this that shows how important relationships are.
Definitely. And even, you know, when we're talking about relationships, we're not only talking about those that are outside of work. So yes, agreed, like family, relationships, friends, but even at work, because sometimes we fall into the, you know, the automaticity of, you know, just focusing on our social life outside of work. So we go to work, we do our tasks, we leave, and our social life is outside. But it's also really important to foster those relationships and with the people that you have at work. So caring, you know, about them as a person outside of work. Yeah. And because at the end of the day, you know, you can go and speak to, you know, your friends or your family members or your partners outside of work about things happening at work. But at the end of the day, the people who will understand you probably the most are the people who are at work with you, because they have the same culture as you and they relate to people that you also relate to. And it creates psychological safety. So it's a bit of a buzzword, this idea that, you know, we can be comfortable speaking and being our true selves at work. I mean, that's really fostered when we care about other people in our organization and see them as people and not as robots, you know, fulfilling part of the task or part of the project that they've been assigned to. So, you know, seeing relationships as being both at work and at home, both being important.
In fact, we like to remind ourselves and people that we are human beings, not human doings. Yeah. Because we tend to be doing, and we forget how important it is to be, and this presence and being with other people in meaningful connection is so important.
And it's hard, you know, so yes. Those of us online, sometimes we just join the call, we focus on work and we leave, but it is actually really important to give some time to talk as well about how we're doing and, you know, what have you been up to, any plans for the weekend. They're small things that you would normally do at the office. So for those of us who aren't at the office, we don't have those little coffee breaks to catch up and to talk about other things. So it's important to embed them into even our video calls.
Yes. I imagine some of you out there might be saying, right, so how on earth do I find time to do all this? and especially if there are people with young families, you know, who are, you know, in constant state of doing. our suggestion is not to try and achieve perfection or a perfect balance, but by keeping these in mind and finding every opportunity to find even small changes in the right places can make a difference. Like even 10 minutes of civilized moments when you come back from work before you just jump into caring for the children or doing house chores, just claiming those 10 minutes for you to take a quiet cup of tea and perhaps, you know, just calm down a bit, you know, unless you make it and claim it, people around us all want a piece of us. So it's, you know, like we don't expect, and just as we don't do it ourselves, okay, we don't expect perfection. It's just the awareness that for us to be balanced, we need to sort of invest in these five areas. Okay, so I think we can shift slightly now. We're going to look at something which is a little bit more on an organizational level now, for those of you who are, you know, in the business world and in the working world, and perhaps especially for those of you who have a managerial or a leadership position. But this will take we're going to go through it much faster, obviously also because of time. We wanted to give priority to the personal level, but we're also going to include the leadership aspect as well. Joe, do we do the polling now or?
Exactly. So in fact, on the next slide, we have a question for you and a poll is going to come up. And we're, you know, we're wondering which ratio best represents the extent to which employees and organization are responsible for well-being. Okay, so is it all the employee, you know, 100%, or is it the organizational's responsibility? Is it half-half? Is it mostly the employee, or is it mostly the organization? So you can vote now, and we'll discuss the results in a little bit. Again, we can't vote ourselves, but I think anyway, there is one particular ratio which does best represent. So we will talk about that after you guys vote.
Take some thinking, this.
It does, it does. And, you know, there'll be differing opinions. So, you know, it's a pity that we can't have a full-fledged discussion here with you today. But if you have any questions as well, you can just pop them into the Q&A. There'll be some
space for questioning.
Exactly. Okay, yeah. So we have the results. Okay, so no one said 100% the employee. We have a small percentage who said it's the organization, 100%. Then we had the majority, so almost 60%, that is actually 50% the employee and 50% the organization.
Balanced.
About 20% said 60% the employee and 40% the organization. And 22% said that it's more the organization than the employee. Okay, so just some reflections on that. You know, so Pat, I don't know, before we kind of give the answer, whether you want to add anything.
No, it's fine. I mean, you can't.
Okay, so really the way that we see it, the best ratio is 60% the employee and 40% the organization. And the reason that we see that ratio as being sort of the best representation is that it still puts the responsibility on the employee. So, you know, at the end of the day, each of us are responsible for, you know, what we do, our behavior, the way that we feel. But there still is that responsibility, that 40%, you know, it's almost half from the organization to make sure that you know, we're doing well, basically, and overall in our life. I don't know, Pat, if you want to add anything there.
Yeah, no, I think you've put it very well. So yeah, what is interesting is that even the research shows that the trying to have work-life balance, so I'm purposely using that term now, so because it's so familiar, which we are calling a balanced life, and having an organization or an employer that doesn't allow it, that makes it impossible, okay, is obviously self-defeating. So you need input from both sides, and this is where we need to make choices, I guess. You know, you need to make choices in our lives and prioritize what is really important and what is worth, you know, dedicating our time for. I will now take you through some very, very quickly, because I'm aware of the time and I want to make sure that there's space for questions. So the last 10 minutes of this presentation. So what leaders can be doing? So first of all, definitely to start conversations with colleagues and teams about well-being and mental health, and open it up as a subject that's okay to discuss, because this balance that we're talking about has a direct relationship to mental health and to well-being. We can practically use them interchangeably. If you don't have this kind of balance, you cannot feel well, you cannot function well, and if you're not feeling well, how can you have good mental health? So I think this is something that has grown a lot in these last couple of years. I'm thankful that I think we're talking more openly about this, about mental health issues in the workplace. And there are organizations that are doing really good work in this area. And I think that, you know, it's a growing concern with a growing response from the side of organizations as well. Definitely that we take reports of stress, burnout seriously. You know, I think it's something that is important, that we don't brush it off and say it's just stress. One of the things that irritates me sometimes, Joe, is that, you know, we go to the doctor with a complaint and they tell you it's nothing, it's just stress. And I say, you know, it's not exactly nothing. So
no, actually, I mean, we know that long-term stress and you know, it affects the body actually in many, many ways. So stress is not something to ignore.
And it wears down our immunity too. So it's something that we need to take seriously.
We do. We get more sick when we're stressed.
So like increased autonomy and involvement in decisions, especially decisions that will impact the well-being of our employees and of our team, and putting well-being on the strategic table in a way, so making it, you know, an important KPI in a sense that
committing to it, right, and placing responsibility and you know, keeping it at the forefront of our minds and not letting it just kind of, you know, fade into the background when more important, you know, maybe projects come up.
Okay, so in conclusion, we're going to take you through the same five domains in terms of achieving balance, but this time we're going to take it from the leadership perspective. Okay, so we'll go through them, and then we'll open up this broadcast for some questions. So basically, the physical domain, the responsibility here is to create a safe working environment, promote health and well-being, as we said before, and encourage support and rest. And believe it or not, this might sound like music to your ears, but some employers might cringe a bit about this, is that discourage people from working long hours, unnecessarily long hours, like discourage them. And we say this because we know that working more than 10 hours a day eventually will wear you down, performance will drop, health will drop, and we know statistically that it will actually cost the company more in terms of attrition and sickness and mistakes and bad performance than if that person was working within normal kind of.
Exactly. And that really relates to the culture that, you know, you're creating as a leader. You know, at the end of the day, you're modeling behavior for your whole team. So when you model behaviors that encourage, you know, being continuously connected, for example, expecting people to be available at all times of the day, you know, it's okay if, you know, we all have different working patterns. Some of us like to wake up at 6 a.m. and start work then. Some of us like to work at 10 p.m. or even later. But just, you know, making it clear to everyone that although maybe I work at that time and I send you an email at that time, maybe I don't expect you to reply until, you know, it's your working hours, basically.
Exactly. So that's the physical domain. And if we move on to the emotional domain, again, it's giving motivation and motivating teams priority, supporting employees and strengthening resilience. There are various, like there's direct training on resilience building, but also in terms of promoting these areas of well-being within the work itself and within the workplace. And one thing that is very critical, and we should actually take this for granted, but unfortunately we come across a lot of situations where it's lacking, that we always treat employees with dignity and respect. I guess this is another non-negotiable, but unfortunately we do come across quite a few situations where dignity and respect are lacking. But this is something definitely that impacts the emotional well-being of individuals.
Especially in the fast pace, right, that we live in, sometimes we kind of just speak to people very quickly, not treating them as people, you know, and just expecting, you know, results and nothing else.
Exactly. Okay. In the cognitive domain, we have the provision of opportunities for growth and development, offer mentors and coaches for people to have support and in their development and career progression. And again, the personal part of looking for opportunities for learning, ongoing learning, can be also shifted on the organization to provide those opportunities for ongoing learning as well. So, you know, this is how the interplay works. So I look for the opportunity and I'm also given the opportunity on both levels. Moving on. Sorry, Joe, you wanted to...
Apologies, guys, if you hear my dog barking in the background.
I didn't hear her. So
good, good. I've been using this a bit. So but every time a dog passes, she gets excited.
That's part of remote working, isn't it?
Like it is.
You get dogs, cats, children jumping on.
Yeah, that's the personal life, you know, pushing into the work life right there.
So in the spiritual domain, again, we an organization does well to, leaders do well to focus on purpose and connect employees to the values. And I know that APS takes this very seriously, this area. Very, very conscious and very dedicated to values and to promoting those values and to promoting people in terms of the behaviors that represent those values, okay? Because, you know, values can we call them poster values when they're just, you know, there for to be seen on the wall. But living those values and having an organization that is value driven, okay, will automatically encourage decisions, actions, behaviors, attitudes that are in line with the values of the organization. So if before we talked about dignity and respect, and here we are making sure that the leaders are living examples of dignity and respect, then that sense of well-being will cascade and infuse the whole organization. Finally, we have the social domain. And again, we have the concept of fostering a friendly social environment at the workplace, creating opportunities for fun, because people who work together and have fun together work better. We know that for sure. And the idea of moving away from anonymity. Anonymity is one of the biggest demotivators and sources of lack of well-being in the workplace. When you feel that you're just a number, we hear this complaint quite a lot. I feel that I'm just a number. So getting to know your people, getting to know, you know, their life, what makes them tick, without obviously intruding, but is another area that is critical for balance. So these are the five domains, the five balanced domains seen from the perspective of leadership. Right, so we have literally 2 minutes left. So we're just going to take you through a couple of slides with some tips on helping when we have family responsibilities. So one of the biggest challenges, and I think COVID brought this right in the front of our noses, mm-hmm. was how on earth do you balance your life when you also have a young family to deal with? And these are just some top tips, not rocket science, but maybe things that you can like reflect on as well. So from a personal perspective, we need to be assertive and make sure that family chores and responsibility are fairly distributed. So this includes planning ahead and thinking ahead. And this is where, so I'm going to take a bit of a risk here and appeal for men, especially, to step up. Because the research shows us in general, that especially with COVID, it came out very, very clearly that very often it's the women who have to cater for family responsibilities, family chores, and household chores, even if both are career professionals. There's a lot of research, not only in Malta, this has happened across the globe, where women were hugely disadvantaged, once again, when it came to the stress and anxiety and burnout during COVID. Okay? So I think we honestly need to step up and look at family life and family chores as part of our load. So we're not helping, we are sharing, okay? Because
definitely.
Even the best sometimes say, yes, but I help a lot, and help implies that it's not really your job.
Get all the stuff. Even if we, sorry, go on.
No, go ahead, Joe.
I was just going to add, like, even if we remove gender from the picture, you know, there are typical roles that we just take on automatically sometimes. Yeah. You know, be it with your family or with your partner, these roles, we need to challenge them sometimes and just realize sort of, am I doing the best I can, the most I can to support, you know, everyone in the relationship, basically, especially because it's very common that everyone is working. So exactly. We all have multiple roles that we're playing all the time.
That's it. So get all the support you can. Don't be ashamed to reach out, because some people are ashamed because it might seem like we're not coping, but if we need help, reach out for help. Let go of perfection and find useful shortcuts. I think that's really important. Give children or dependents all the responsibility they can manage, as in don't do things for others that they can do for themselves, and try to ignore social judgment based on redundant stereotypes, as in, you know, you shouldn't be doing this work, because you are of this particular, you have this role, mm-hmm. you shouldn't be doing that thing. So, you know, I think that's really important. From an organizational point of view, we encourage people to encourage flexi time, flexi locations to accommodate work and family schedules. So reward value time, not face time. Okay, so it's the results which count. Allow paid sick leave for caring for sick children or to take them to the doctor. Rework policies and practices and systems in order to create a new normal that benefits all. Schedule respectfully, keeping in mind the balance, okay, and the lifestyle of people. Build a culture of collaboration where opinions are gathered and validated. And finally, make idea generation remote friendly, so that even in a hybrid environment, which now seems to have become the new normal has taken this shape now, more or less, in most companies, of a hybrid environment. Okay, make sure that we don't forget about inclusion and get everyone on board and make idea generation remote friendly. Okay, we've reached the end. I don't know if you wanted to add something, Joe.
No, I mean, thank you everyone for joining us, you know, on Zoom and on a Facebook Live. We'll invite you now to, you know, if you'd like to pop any questions into the question and answer section, and we'll be answering those now.
So thank you very much for your presentation. Thank you. Very insightful. So we have a few questions which have come in so far. So first one, if I work for a company that does not value having a balanced life, what could I do?
Yeah, so that's okay. So Joe and I decided that the difficult questions will be answered by Joe and the easy ones will be.
good one.
So Joe is going to have to answer this one. No.
Go ahead, Pat. We'll be answering them together as well.
I'm joking. Very funny. Okay, so I think in these situations we have four options. Okay, so option one, which is the least favorable, is to just do nothing and complain, because that doesn't get us anywhere, right? So that just makes us more depressed. Option two is to try to adapt as much as we can. So try to be as flexible as we can and adapt to the needs. And try to find ways of working around them. So that's active adaptation. Mm-hmm. Option three is literally speaking up and doing something about it. Okay, so
boundaries,
use the leaders, use HR, like, you know, try to create pressure and speak up about the need and make it clear. Option four, I think you all know what it is. You know, we usually oscillate between option two and option three. So accept and adapt and try to be flexible, choose your battles and speak up and try to bring change. When those things don't work, you might want to reconsider whether you want to work with that particular environment or whether it is more healthy for you to move out and try to find something else. Obviously, this is not possible for everyone, depends on circumstances, financial stability, age, you know, it can be very difficult. But I think speaking up and creating more awareness and pressure about the importance of this can perhaps make a difference. So I think I'm seeing a note there for the.
Oh, that's really nice. So yeah, we have someone who just added that they actually spoke to HR about the need for a health coach at work, and it's going really well for them. So thanks for sharing that. I mean,
there you go.
It's proof that, you know, speaking up even when it's difficult can actually really have positive outcomes.
Mm-hmm.
Thanks for sharing.
Okay, that's great. So next question, which of the five domains of well-being is the most important and why?
Right, okay, this is a trick question.
Because agreed.
In reality, there isn't one that is more important than the others. They're all equally important. And what we recommend is that you look at your life and see what's possible and what's realistic and do what you can. So this is why earlier on Joe mentioned that it's an organic model and not a fixed one. So there are times when you want to say, look, at the moment, I don't have that much time for, you know, the physical domain that has to, you know, wait a bit and has to shrink a bit. So maybe I can put in 10 minutes of exercise and that's all I can do. But at least I can focus more on the cognitive, for example. Okay, so yeah, that's a bit of a trick question because there isn't one that is more important than the others, but in reality, they are five equally important investments.
Agreed. They, you know, they'll fluctuate throughout your life. They'll change depending on the individual. So very, very unique, I would say.
Great. So another question's come in. How do you suggest an employee manage different social and cultural contexts in terms of communication, both verbal and nonverbal, that hinder social life at work?
Wow. All right. This is
a good question.
Yeah. Can you all stay till 9? Okay. So I'm actually reading the question again. So an employee, how do such an employee manage different social and cultural contexts? Yeah. Yeah, I guess this is not easy because in Malta, we are quite new to cultural diversity in the workplace. So for example, both Joe and I, Joe actually more than me, lived in Canada for a number of years. Joe spent her first 12 years and I spent 2 years working there. And we know that it's such an inclusive culture and the attitude is that they don't only tolerate diversity, they don't only accept diversity, but they appreciate diversity.
Mm-hmm.
And once you have that, the social boundaries and will start falling. Why? Because I remember when I was there, Joe, I don't know what, well, you were born there. So, well, not exactly born there because Joe's an interesting case. She has three citizenships. So yep. She's a US citizen, a Canadian citizen, and a Maltese citizen.
Passport for life.
Yeah, three passports.
The whole world.
Mm-hmm. But in reality, what I found was that they used to be really interested in my culture. So I experienced what it means to be a cultural minority. And the interest and the respect that I received actually triggered social life because we were socializing by sharing different norms, different cultures, the way we do things, okay? And rather than seeing it as a threat because it's different, it was seen as, wow, how interesting, is that how you do things, you know? So,
it's a really good point you're raising. And to, you know, to answer your question, the idea that we should be curious and open and respectful towards everyone, you know, and I think, you know, you mentioned in terms of communication and you know, how can we do that both verbal and nonverbal? And you've raised a really good point because, you know, in different cultures, for example, different nonverbals mean different things.
Yes.
And I think you have an example because I've forgotten it, but you mentioned it last time that in different cultures, like one symbol or gesture can mean something totally different.
Yeah, even nodding, the yes and the no. Yeah.
And gestures.
The hand gestures.
So it's a good point. And I think the trick is that when you notice something that you're not sure what it means, for example, and so, for example, even in terms of, you know, the generation that uses social media and messaging much more than others, for example, for me, ... typically meant, you know, awkwardness. And Pat uses it all the time. And I told him, listen, like, what does that mean when you use ... What does it mean? And he told me, you know, it just means I'm filling the gaps and moving on to a new topic. So,
like, you know, there's more to say about this.
But when you notice something in communication that doesn't make sense to you, it's good to just raise it, you know, and ask the person, you know, what does it mean when you do this hand gesture, or, you know, when you don't message me until 2 days later, are you avoiding me or are you busy? And usually it explains itself out, and there was no, you know, need to actually be worrying about it. So I hope that answers your question.
It's a tough question to answer.
A big question.
But I think we need to, as a culture, we need to move away from the mentality of segregation. And it's really tricky because we sometimes, I notice that local people sometimes complain that people from other countries, international people, they stick together and don't mix. But on the other hand, those people say that they're not encouraged to mix and they're not encouraged to integrate. Like, for example, we're in the canteen and there are people who don't speak Maltese. There are the Maltese who know how to speak English but don't make the effort to speak English. So how can you ever take part in a conversation or laugh at a joke if it's not in a language that you're understanding, that all you're hearing is noise? So you know, it goes both ways. But one thing that we learn is that the importance of cultural empathy as well. And cultural empathy goes both ways. So when you go into a culture, you also try to be flexible and get interested in that culture and try to, you know, participate in it. It doesn't mean you absorb it, but you participate in it. And when it goes both ways, we build bridges, you know, rather than walls. And that's one way of doing it, you know, like really getting interested in each other's culture. You know, for me, we are a human race and that's it. It stops there. All other boundaries are artificial. But, you know, not everyone sees it like
man-made.
That. You know.
They're very man-made at the end of the day.
I like to see us as citizens of planet Earth rather than just a country, you know. But anyway, maybe next time.
So we haven't had any other questions from the audience. So we've come to the end of our session. And thank you both of you very much for very insightful session. It has, and also thank you to our audience who have joined us today. And we'll be uploading the recording of the session on the bank's YouTube channel and our Facebook page over the coming days. And you'll be receiving a feedback form as we'd like to continue developing these sessions further. We hope that you'll join us for our upcoming APS talks. More information will be available on our website and social media in due course. Thank you. And everyone, have a lovely evening. And thank you, Patrick and Joanne. Been lovely.
Thank you, everyone. Thanks for joining. Thanks for having us, inviting us to speak.
Very well.
Thank you. Bye.